An hour early, you're on perfectly on time. We're going to go ahead and start our singing with Come Now Is the Time to Worship. And as you are able, would you please stand as we sing together? Here we go.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your one day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Willingly we choose to surrender our lives. Willingly our knees will bow.
Please. As you work your way back to your seats, please remain standing as you are able. We're going to continue our singing as you are able. Here we go.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power.
Precious blood of the Lamb.
much for your singing. Would you go to the Lord in prayer with me today? Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day that we come together, that we can encourage one another, but we're here to worship you, be it in song, be it in the sermon, be it in the offering time, being in the communion time to remember what you've done for each and every one of us. We are so thankful for that. As we get ready for the fall season, we're remembering the Thanksgiving time, the Christmas time, and that it's just for your glory that we do these things. And as we do them, we just ask that you be here among us. As we continue on today, pray that you be here with Rick, and that as the sermon comes, and that we have the open hearts, the open ears, and that we will just do these things for you. And along that line, just pray as we sing these songs that it'll be from our hearts to you. As we continue on, we thank you for all the blessings you give each and every day. And then as we are your disciples, followers, that we just do it in your sweet sound to you and for your service. And it's in your Son's name I pray. Amen. Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who saves the spells in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all things. This is amazing grace.
Now, and we'll have people throughout the room, and if you have a prayer request, a prayer time, they will be available here. If you'd rather write that request or praise on the white piece of paper in the bulletin, welcome to do that. Put it in the offering plate as it goes by.
Deep the Father's love for. was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. But
good morning, everybody. Need you to pretty please get your Bibles out, get to Matthew chapter 10, whether it's going to be a phone or your hardback Bible. Need you to get to Matthew chapter 10. There's also a sermon outline in the worship folder that I'd really appreciate you to have on hand. Love for you to have a pen or a pencil too, but at least the outline to follow along. We've got some guests today. We've been in a series for a while now where we're going through the Gospel of Matthew. And we started off and we see in the initial chapters that there's this declaration of who Jesus is, who he's been from on old, and what he's come to do. We get into chapter 5 and we have the beginning of the Beatitudes and these kingdom teachings that you've been told this, but with the coming of the kingdom, Jesus, here's this. Let me tell you how it really is. Right after the Beatitudes, we've got a series of miracles that testify to the truthfulness of his claims of who he is and what he's come to do. And now we're in the end of chapter 9, chapter 10, and there's this transition that's going on. It's been all about Jesus. We've been calling it a Jesus-shaped mission. It's all about Jesus, but now there's a handing off. There's a sending out. And we're kind of wondering, we were to read chapter 10 this past week. I hope many of you did. Good job. You even got notes. Where we fit in this? Is this descriptive or is this a pattern? How do we read? How do we understand what's going on right now in Matthew? So that's where we are right now. There's this transition, and we're going to talk about how we're to understand this rather difficult chapter, all right? Would you pray with me? Oh, Father, thank you for your love. Thank you that you have sent that love in the person of Jesus. Thank you for what your love means and accomplishes, that there's purpose tied to your Son and his coming and dying and rising again, the hope in his coming return that shapes our decisions, our lives, even today. We want understanding, Lord. You've given us your word to not only reveal who you are, but show us the way, and we need your understanding. We need your help. I pray today, please, that we gain some of that. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Once you come to know Christ and you invest yourself in a local congregation, wherever that might be, I assume most people want or would like certain things for and from that congregation. You want God's word to be taught. You want it to be relevant. You want to make a difference in your community and the world around you. You want the whole thing to be meaningful to you and your family. You want it, the church, his people, to be there when it counts. And I bet we could keep going, make a pretty long list. As a preacher, I've got some of those same wants and longings. But towards the top of my list would it be to be a part of a congregation that's growing into a church, meaning a gathered people, that is becoming what Christ has been laying out for us in the last couple weeks. And to be honest, I'd have a few wish list type things that I'd stick on top of it as well. I'd want most people to be a part of a small group, because that's the environment that I've seen people most often grow, most and fastest, and it's the way that God has shown that he blesses, accelerates and deepens Christ-like growth. And hand in hand with that, I long for God's people to learn and be comfortable with reading God's word for themselves. To be able to sit down and read and know and receive that God is speaking directly to you through his Holy Spirit and his written word. Because that gift is life-changing on a daily basis. But like most relationships, that kind of closeness to develop on a regular basis, there's this getting to know you process that needs to happen. I think Matthew chapter 10 can help us grow or develop a little in that process. If you were here last week, I asked you to not only read chapter 10 in the Gospel of Matthew in advance of coming today, but also study it. Even maybe take a little notebook and write down questions as you go, because I firmly believe that this chapter ought to invite questions on a part of Christ Church today, such as, you got your sermon outlines? Point number one on your sermon outline for today. It's very simple, direct. And I think an essential question for us to learn to ask today as we read God's word for itself. Number one, is he talking to me or them? And while we're at it, who's the them that he's talking to first? This is important because I don't know if I want to say most often, but we often open and read God's word through the lens of the personal question, what's God saying to me? That's the first layer that we go through. When our first question, if we want to hear God rightly, probably needs to be along the lines of a more historical slant of what did God say to them? That can save us from the extreme of, I want to see what God has to say to me. And we start, none of you have ever done this, we start randomly flipping pages, you know, and looking for a word from God today. And we might open to something like Luke 9:23, and we see there that Jesus said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. And we kind of look at that and say, that's a little dark for today. Let's look some more. And Matthew 19:21, Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go and sell all your possessions and give to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and then come follow me. And it's kind of like, oh, come on, you know, let's go backwards. Let's look a little bit more. And we find ourselves in something like Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, and plans to give you hope in the future. Inside we go, there we go. Thank you, Lord, for being that kind of God and speaking to me today. You know, it's just boom, boom, boom. This one I kind of like. And I bet you can see real quickly how we might miss something pretty important from the Lord if we would largely read his word in such a fashion. You want to know why we often go from beginning to end in one of his books, whether it's Hebrews or John or Matthew? It's this one, so that we make sure that we don't miss something important. So what I'd like for you to hear first today are that there's some passages in the Bible that we will misunderstand and misapply if we don't first understand who the original author and the audience were. And as we come to our text, Matthew 10, once we realize who's doing the talking, Jesus, and to whom he's talking, specifically the apostles, then we can better determine if what Jesus said to the 12 applies directly or indirectly to us today. First, note to whom Jesus is talking. You got your Bibles? I just want you to check with me as we go through here. Look at 9:37. It says that he's talking to his disciples. That term appears six times in our text. At the beginning, chapter 9, verse 37, chapter 10, verse 1. It appears in the middle, chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. And at the end, chapter 10, verses 42 and chapter 11, verse 1. All the way through, we know who he's talking to. The word, if you look, also in chapter 10, verse 1, those disciples are further defined as being his 12 disciples, and in verse 2, as the apostles. Now, that word apostle is used here for the first and only time in the Gospel of Matthew. Ought to make us perk our ears up a little bit, you know, compared with like 29 times in the book of Acts. And we can see that these same apostles are even named in verses 2 to 4 of our text in Matthew chapter 10. As one commentator wrote, those names are given to us. They're listed here as they are in three other places in the New Testament. Mark 3, Mark, Luke 6, Acts 1. I like this. Not merely to help us name our children in churches and hospitals, but so that we might know whom Jesus is addressing and their significance. So we back up and we take a larger view. We see that Jesus is, number one, remember Ezekiel chapter 34 that I referred to last week, and the context that Jesus was addressing when we see verse 36, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. Why? Because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. The condemnation that we find against God's leaders for his people way back in Ezekiel 34. Well, we see here that Jesus is replacing Israel's present ungodly leaders with the 12, chapter 10, verse 1, and chapter 11, verse 1. If you know your Bible and how things correspond, the number 12 corresponding to the 12 tribes of Israel. And number 2, he's beginning to build his church, as Paul would later say, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20, on the foundation of the apostles. We got something important. There's a shift going on here. So do you see to whom Jesus is talking in our text? He's not talking to you and me. He's talking to the 12. But what, if anything, did he say to the 12 that is not said also to us? Or said in a different way, what's different about their call and mission and ours? I think there's at least two primary differences on your outlines. Two major differences between them and us. Number one, need you to fill in the blank, is what we would call apostolic, right in the word, authority. Apostolic authority. We can save an awful lot of error and presumption as long as we get this straight, all right? In Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, Jesus calls his 12 disciples and he gives them authority. Look at it. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure, depending on your translation, or unclean spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. Later on, this same authority, Matthew 16, 19, will enable them to bind and loose sins and in Acts to preach the gospel boldly through the power of the Spirit. But here, the emphasis is on healing powers, authority over demons and diseases. Now, I think it's especially interesting and important to note that the Great Commission, not the commission of the 12 here, but the Great Commission directed to all followers of Jesus, including you and me, it doesn't mention healing at all. Yet here, in the commission of the 12 apostles, we find, chapter 10, verse 8, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Now, what do we do with this? How do we read it? I think we can and should acknowledge that God can and will do whatever he wants, when he wants, and through whomever he wants. We dare not put him in a box and declare what he can or can't do. And I know that God has done and still does miraculous things to this day, but it's not, and the key word I think would be normative, like it was for the apostles back in the day. There's a difference between the apostolic age of Christianity and our age. There's a difference between the apostles' powers or authority and ours. There's a difference between 2 Corinthians 12:2. Write that down. Excuse me. 2 Corinthians 12:12. Where Paul says the marks of a true apostle, including signs, wonders, and miracles. There's a big difference between that and the permanent qualification for Christian leadership today as given in the pastoral epistles for elders and deacons. They're not the same. So the first difference between them, the 12, and us is that they had unique apostolic authority, power to preach and to heal. The second is perhaps more obvious. One person has called it the scope and severity of their mission. I have it on your sermon outline, the who and what of the mission. Look at Matthew 10, verses 5 and 6. If you read this, it probably stuck out at you. You'll see that they were only commissioned to take the gospel to whom? To the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Not to Gentiles or Samaritans. But in obedience to the Great Commission, we are to take the gospel, Matthew 28, verse 19, to all nations, to all peoples, to all ethnos. Later on, after Pentecost, their mission's going to expand as well. But right now, chapter 10, verse 23, the apostles must go through, and again I quote, through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Chapter 10, verse 23. And just for clarification, I believe that last part refers not to Jesus' second coming, like we often read it through our lens on this side of the cross, but to his death and resurrection. Something had to be accomplished before his death and resurrection. As for the severity or how their commission was carried out, we're not as aware as what we need to be, but I know that Christians, and especially Christian workers throughout the world, have and still do to this day suffer. There are statistics that show there are a bit more persecuted Christians in our age than all the other ages put together. They suffer economically through outright persecution, but not like these guys. Not like the first 12. Jesus warns the first 12 here in Matthew 10 that slander and suffering and death await them. And according to history, all but Judas, who would hang himself, and John, who would be exiled to the island of Patmos, they all died a martyr's death. Bartholomew and James, the son of Zebedee, and Matthias, who was Judas's replacement, they were all beheaded. Thomas and Matthew were speared to death. Peter, Andrew, Philip, Jude, Simon the Zealot, and James the son of Alphaeus were crucified. As Douglas Sean O'Donnell writes, so yes, we, meaning you and me, are called to share in the sufferings of Christ. 2 Timothy 3:12 talks to us. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. O'Donnell continues, but not always to suffer unto death. We must pick up our crosses, but such crosses don't always lead to Roman execution. So a real quick review to this point. As we read Matthew chapter 10, who's Jesus talking to, them or me? And who's the them anyway? And now we can recognize that Jesus was talking to them, the original 12 apostles. And two major differences between them and us is what we can call apostolic authority that involved healing and special circumstances, and also the who and the what of their original outreach and outcome. So at one point, Jesus was talking straight to the 12 that are specifically named and not directly to you and me. But number two on outlines, there is some stuff that's written that applies to all of us, including you and me. Number two on your outlines. Yes, he's talking to them and me and you. All I'm saying is there is application for you and me in this chapter. The Gospel of Matthew was not written simply as a history book. It was written to share Jesus Christ and provide his followers with a manual for Christian discipleship. So what do we take away from Matthew chapter 10 that should apply to us, meaning even you and me? Got a series of bullets. Let's just run through them real quick. First bullet under point number two on your sermon outline. Our motive for ministry is compassion and the basic means of harvesting that he called us to back at the end of chapter 9, our prayer and people. We've learned from our time spent in the last couple weeks in Matthew 9, verses 35 and following, that like Jesus, we are to be compassionate. We're to pray, and with prayer comes increased compassion. And we're to work. In short, we're to be like Jesus. This whole thing is Jesus-shaped. Second bullet, we don't have to be great to reach the least. I want you to notice again, primarily, who was receptive to the message of Jesus. They were the ones that the religious leaders of the day largely turned away from. They're called the lost sheep of Israel. They're not the first and foremost. They weren't the richest and finest. Rather, they were categorized as the crowds, the common, the people of the land. And who did Jesus pick, commission even, to reach them in his name? Folks, the only titles that they bore were such as fishermen. Zealot, one who betrayed Jesus, and even a tax collector. We're not talking high society or the rich and famous here, folks. 1 Corinthians 1:26, you and me. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. He's talking to you and me, folks. Third bullet. Our character is to commend Christ. Got your Bibles? Jump down to verse 40 in chapter 10. Just kind of skim through there. Who we are and everything we do is to point back to Jesus. The whole mission, including you and me, is to be Jesus-shaped. Next bullet. We are to give the same gospel announcement. Like the apostles, we are to give the same gospel announcement. Chapter 10, verse 7, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I'm going to quote from Douglas Sean O'Donnell at this time from his commentary, Gospel of the Matthew. O'Donnell writes, I say gospel announcement intentionally, because both here and in Acts, the Christian message is not so much a suggestion or even an offer, such as, God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life if you'll welcome him into your heart. Rather, it's an announcement of the good news of the kingdom. The good news is that God, in the person of Christ, has sent from heaven his own Son as king. God has demonstrated Jesus to be king through his life, teachings, miracles, sufferings, death, and resurrection, all in fulfillment of Scripture and all witnessed in history. Therefore, as it's quoted elsewhere, the time of ignorance is over. And the time for repentance, Mark 6:12, and faith is here. For God has, Acts 17:31, set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Either you submit to Christ and receive eternal life, or you do not submit and thus incur his judgment. O'Donnell continues, and this preacher, and I think we all need to hear this, it is often preached in churches today that God can change your life. God can help you find yourself. God can help you love yourself. God can give you peace of mind. God can save your marriage or get you a new job or help to be a success in the world. Such messages will not cause persecution, will they? The world loves those messages. They'll buy your book and watch your TV show. But if you preach what Jesus said and what the apostles preached, that Jesus is the only way to God because he is from God, chapter 10, verse 40, and therefore we must have allegiance to him even above our closest family members, verse 37, and that judgment is a reality since God, verse 28, can destroy both soul and body in hell, then you can expect persecution. You can expect persecution for heeding Jesus' commands on how to think, live, and witness to the world. Preach the gospel of the kingdom, and what happens? Exactly what Jesus said would happen. Persecution. Jesus wasn't just talking to the apostles here. He was also talking to you and me. Last bullet point. Our mission is dangerous and divisive, but it's worth giving everything we have. We just talked about how the mission, even the mission that you and I carry today, can be dangerous and it can also be divisive. I've watched many, many times how the truth and grace of Jesus has healed and restored homes and families that were once divided and on a course for becoming undone. But I've also seen what happens when a home becomes divided, when one in the household turns to Christ and the other not only resents but undermines that same decision with everything that he or she can muster. Verse 34, do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Serious question, church. What do we do with that? My best answer. We trust him. We trust him. In your reading, did you notice all the motives that Jesus gives for perseverance? Jesus teaches that we must expect, endure, and not fear persecution. But I don't know about you, I can stop in the middle of my reading and kind of say, but why? You know, why not fear or turn back? Here's what we know. This path, this is the way that Jesus went. He suffered. We will suffer. But through our suffering for the gospel, we identify with Christ. We turn to him. We learn faith. We read beyond this. We get into the book of Acts. We look at God's word. Such persecution will not impede the gospel, it actually promotes it. Think what happened initially with this dispersion from Jerusalem, how they were all sent out. What happened? The gospel spread, took over the Roman Empire. What would have happened if they all stayed in Jerusalem? Hang on to this one. God knows how many hairs are on your head. He knows when I shouldn't call it stupid. He knows when a sparrow falls to the ground And with fatherly love, the same God is with you even through your sufferings. You can know that. And finally, probably most of all, following Jesus, according to Jesus, it's worth it. Chapter 10, verse 39, you got it? The NIV says, whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. The New Living Translation, I like it here. It says, if you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. You got one of those where we're reading through, and is he talking to me? Is he talking? He's talking to you and me. What is it, folks? Be real, because either he's real or not. Either he really rose from the dead or he didn't, and he did. So what is it that we're still clinging to instead of letting go and fully embracing him? Because if we'll let go and turn to, it's worth it because of who he is and what he's done. And folks, that truth, that promise wasn't just given to the apostles. It's given, it's offered to you and me. That's one we get to take home with us. So, we read all this. I don't know about you, but to me it's confusing. Got to sort stuff out, you know? I scratch my head. I do some talking. I got to read some other places. I read Matthew chapter 10. There's a transition. I've been following pretty good all the way to here, and now it's kind of, what do I do with this? My best answer. Trust Jesus. Follow him, because we know he's trustworthy. How? He not only came and said and did what he said he was going to do, he rose from the dead, and that makes all the difference in the world. Amen? Let's pray. Father, ask something at the beginning of this. We're just thank you for Jesus and using him to reveal who you are. We want to know him and follow him, and even according to your grace, become like him in a greater way. We want your work, your transformation of us as individuals, but also the mission you've given us as your people to grow and increase and abound. We get stuck in our own stuff. Sometimes lack of understanding. A heart that's not fully placed on you, Lord. I pray, please, through this time spent with you, this digging in and reading and some kind of increased understanding of who you are, what you hold for us, that there's a move that you can bless and work, even in us, and by your grace, the world around us. Make it happen, Lord, please. May we allow you, long for you, to make it happen in us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. What's our song? We got it from four people, so we got it. I bet it's the right answer. We come to the altar, which is we bring ourselves, right? We're going to sing a song. We're going to ask prayer partners to come up. If you'd like to pray, it helps. You can sit down right where you are. Jesus has made that possible, but it sometimes helps to pray with another. Sometimes we don't know what to pray other than, what would you have for me? Now, show it to me, Lord. And give me the heart to follow. Let's stand. Let's sing together, please.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Good morning. So Rick asked the question, what do we do with that? What next? And I kept coming to Romans chapter 12. During this time of communion, it's the first of the month. Yes, so we get to take this all together as a family. So that's why I kept coming back to Romans chapter 12 here. To which Paul tells us right away, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Further down, he says, by grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, think not more highly of yourself than you ought to. But think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of his faith that God has assigned. For as one body, though we are many, Members do not all have the same functions, but we are one in the body of Christ, individual members with one another, having separate gifts and different passions and different desires. Then further on, marks of true Christian, it tells us, Paul tells us and reiterates, let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in the Spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. So we get this God-sized mission that's been given to us, and we come to the table and this opportunity for the communion table to remind ourselves that we're part of this bigger mission together, right? And on the night that he was betrayed, he had the Last Supper with his disciples, whom he later called the apostles. I don't know if you know, but the word apostle means one sent. We had a Bible college professor used to grab a penny out of his pocket and he'd flip it over and said, this is what the apostle means, and it said 1 cent on the back of it, right? But he's sitting with his apostles and he's sitting with his disciples who he's been with for the last 3 years, and he's having this meal together and he says, this is my body. Take and eat. We can take the cup. And in that same manner, he took the cup and he blessed it with his disciples, with his apostles, and said, this is my body, this is the new covenant. Or sorry, this is my blood, this is the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me together as a family. We can take. Lord, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you so much for the opportunity to be a part of your big mission, be a part of your big master plan in redeeming and bringing healing and togetherness to our world, and just to being able to be a part of your grand design for all things. We love you and we thank you so much for involving us in that. We thank you so much for your grace and your mercy. And it's in your name we pray for those things. Offering. Yes, so now we come to that time of the service. I always forget that it follows right after. It's almost like it's every time. We come to that part of the service where we give back, and we are financially able to contribute to what God's got going on in Haver, at Fifth Avenue, in Hill County, in Montana, and beyond, right? So let's pray over our offering together, would you please? Lord, I just ask for an extra measure of blessing over the gift that it's received today. I ask for an extra measure of blessing over the giver who is giving out of faith and out of confidence, since you will be able to multiply and do wondrous things with these tithes, Father. We desire for our money and our resources, though given to us from you to begin with, we desire for them to be given back and multiplied for your glory, Father. Not for ours, not for the sake of Fifth Avenue and how cool we are, but for your glory, Father. We thank you so much for who you are. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
If you wouldn't mind, would you grab your worship folders, pretty please? We have visitors today. There's a white page, a white insert in there. If you wouldn't mind filling out the one side, we would love for you to take that just so that we can know who you are. And if you go back to that back table after service, we've got a gift for you. The other side of that white page is for prayer concerns, praises. We would love to pray alongside of you if you would like to use that. The lime electric green thing. One side was the sermon outline. Back side are some study questions over what we spent some time in today to help you to go a little bit further and talk to God some more about it. As far as announcements, just real quick, trunk or treat. There were about a list this long of community activities. We still had a bunch of cards that showed. Truthfully, we're having some questions whether we continue. But what was confirmed was we got a chance to say face to face, hi, we're here, we're a safe place. We love Jesus and we'd like for you to love him too. To more people in one night than we probably will have a chance to for the entire rest of the year. So it's an opportunity. We're going to pray about it. But whatever good was accomplished the other night was made possible by you all giving hundreds and hundreds of pounds of candy. You know, it's listed here. I did a couple quick math, and I don't like the results, so I'm not going to share it. But if you look up the average cost for a pound of Halloween candy today and multiply it times the number of pounds, we invested in our community. But we just don't get shots like that to say, here's where we are. We'd love for you to come back. That might make a difference. Backside of your worship folder. Next week is our congregational Thanksgiving dinner. That doesn't seem right. But I guess it gives some people permission to put up the Christmas tree already. I don't know. But next week is Thanksgiving dinner. We've got lots of sign-up sheets back there because, as you see on the thing, we need volunteers, servers, cleanup people for it to make it happen, and it's going to happen. And we're going to have lots of people outside of our congregation be here as well. It's okay to invite people. But we're going to need help to pull it off. So before you leave today, if you're a part of this congregation, would you please sign up back there? Find a place to serve. Ladies, you got a date coming up, men's breakfast next Saturday, and that's going to conclude our announcements. Would you please stand? We say hi at the beginning of the service. We got people that come in. Make sure you say hi on the way out too, okay? Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for setting Jesus before us. And all the grace that comes with him. Father, I pray, please. We want to thank you for a time we gather in your name in this body to remember. But I'm praying, please, that as we go forward this day, this isn't just a one time a week coming before you, but this is our posture before you each day. And as we pray and we turn in your name to others, you use us to glorify you, make Jesus known. May we please have that gift, that honor, this very week. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The song we sang at the beginning has a verse in it. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? We're going to sing that verse again. Here we go.
Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Have a great week. We'll see you next time.